I think this is our third week in guardrails. So if you've got your Bibles, go ahead and, or a Bible on a phone, go ahead and turn to the book of 1 Corinthians. And we're going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. So go ahead and go there. And we'll be jumping into that together. But as you're turning in your Bibles, one of the things that, just a couple words on the announcements. First off, I'm so excited that after a poll of the favorite pastor at this church, it's Pastor Carlos. And that's just fantastic. So make sure that you are here on the 22nd, that you have an opportunity to, if you're a member, we've been like sending out messages and phone calls to make sure all of our members are here for that awesome vote. But everyone in our church, member and otherwise, is invited for the grill and chill afterwards. So make sure you make your lunch plans to be here on that Sunday, which is next Sunday. Yes? Yes, thank you. All right, and then on top of that, we have the awesome opportunity to jump in to that service launch event on the 30th. If you're not registered, if you're a volunteer, or you want to be a volunteer, register for that today or sometime this week so that you can get a part of making sure we got childcare for you and a t-shirt. It's going to be sweet, so make sure you're all about that. Last thing I got to say is this. We didn't talk about this in the announcements, but yesterday we had this awesome event here where we had the opportunity to take out all the chairs in this room and turn this room into a massive garage sale for free, where basically people in our community that have needs, whether they're a single mom or they're just struggling or they just hit a rough patch financially, they just need some stuff to come and enjoy like a lot of cool stuff that you donated so we can give it away for free. And so first off, props to you for donating and saying, look, I have more than I need, I can pass this on. And second off, props to all the amazing volunteers who set this room up, who made it all happen and facilitated that. I saw Mission volunteers walking a volunteer walking a mom through helping her get all that she needed for her kid, single mom, and whether it was clothing or a high chair, I'm trying to remember words of things I don't have to think about anymore. High chair and all these other things. It was cool toys, and it was so cool to be able to see that mom walked out just totally blessed by you guys. And so you guys are making an impact in this community, and we love that. And so just keep doing that. All right, we're in guardrails, and we're starting off in this passage. As you've turned there to in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, Paul is the author here. He's writing to a church in a crazy town area of the world at the time. Just all their ethics were pretty sketchy. It's a town called Corinth. If you think that the world, as far as our outlook on sexuality or lifestyle or personal decisions is a little extreme today, that would be a boring Tuesday in Corinth in the first century. And so Paul's writing a group of people that are trying to follow Jesus with all of their heart, but they're like, man, it's just like, it's really difficult. And so he gets into chapter 6 where he says, basically he starts off like the middle section of it saying, all of us, you know, this is pre-America, all of us want to fight for our rights. All of us believe in freedom. And so like that's something that's not just an American thing. That's a universal human thing. And but he's saying like, in spite of the fact that all of us want our way, our rights right now, my way right away, America now, that type of perspective, whether it's Burger King or not, that's an ancient perspective. And that people always, and so he said that is totally normative and natural, but as followers of Jesus, we have a different perspective that actually informs how we operate with demanding our rights. And he actually gets to the guts of it when he talks about our demanding our rights or even the way that we operate with our body with regard to our sexuality. So if you could stand as we read 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 18 to 20. And Paul says this, flee from sexual immorality. All other sins a person commits are outside the body. But whoever sins sexually sins against their own body. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who's in you, whom you have received from God? You're not your own. You were bought with a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. All right. So one of the key things, the key words that you hear in that passage is this word right here. What is this word? Yeah, we don't use that all that often. Like no one's like, oh, I was in such haste. I fleed. No one says that. Like, I mean, if you said that, you sound like, again, you're going to a Renaissance fair or something. I mean, it's like, no one says flee, unless you're talking about like something your pet has. Flee, this is something that is like really weird. So I don't know why the NIV decided to use that word to describe the word that's in Greek, but basically it means Well, it means flee. But on top of that, it means escape, get out of there, like avoid at all costs. This is a bad situation, getting worse, you got to get out. And so the word flee is escape, evacuate, boom, hit the road. And that's something that we actually had an experience. I had a chance to experience just recently. We had this, I got a chance, this is Braidwood, Illinois. It's actually the Chicago Basin in Colorado. It's a place in Colorado called the Chicago Basin. And the purpose of this trip was to go to this area called the Chicago Basin, set up base camp so that we could wake up at 2 in the morning and start to try to get to the four 14,000-foot peaks that are in surrounding the basin. And if you hit all four, like if you get all four peaks, it's called the Grand Slam. And so my brother Josh and I are like, this sounds amazing. We got to do this. And so like we go ahead and we go there. This picture is our whole team minus a guy named Larry who's like, he already had altitude sickness. And so he stayed back at base camp. He's like, I'm just going to stay back here. We're like, okay, Larry, bye-bye. And we hit the road. Now before attempting to summit any of these 14,000 foot peaks, we had to have some things that were just understanding. We can't summit if these things happen. One was we can't summit if the rocks are wet or frozen. If we get up there and the rocks are wet or frozen, that's a deal breaker because people, well, they die. They can slip and die. And so we don't want that. And so the second thing is we can't summit if it's raining or there's lightning. If it's raining on us, then by nature of rain, the rocks will be wet. But on top of that, you run the risk of getting hit by lightning. And what they found is most people don't die by falling from a 14,000-foot cliff or a peak. They die from either heart attack or getting hit by lightning. And as fun as that sounds to many of us, it ain't. And so if it's wet or frozen ground, if it's lightning or raining on us, we have to evacuate, abort the mission. Or if it's dark. You can't climb and summit a 14,000-foot peak if it's dark. So we're going into this. We're like, okay, boom, let's go ahead and make this happen. And so we started just heading on up higher and higher. Now, we did this in the evening, not at 2 in the morning, because we were in monsoon season, which was just, it was very unfortunate. It was a beautiful week before. It was a beautiful week after we left. But the time we were there was just riddled by these waves of thunderstorms that were coming through. And so we hiked in knowing that there's a chance we wouldn't get a chance to do this. And so we had one window of time, and that was the first evening we got there. And so we just said, okay, we won't be able to get to all four, but maybe we can get to one. And so like we start off to hit one 14,000-foot cliff. And we thought it was going to be like something where we could get up there and get back to base camp within 3 hours. It took much longer than we anticipated. And so after 3 hours of hiking, which was what we thought the whole trip was going to be, we're still not at the summit. In fact, we're about 500 feet from the summit. And so, but 500 feet is so close. But each of us are slowly getting like different degrees of altitude sickness, and we're getting closer and closer. But the thing that caused us to have to turn around was those guardrails. Those things that we said, okay, if it's wet or frozen, if it's lightning or thunderstorm, or if it's dark, those things started to be a reality. And the truth is, lots of people go ahead and try to summit 14,000 feet cliffs in spite of those. They do it anyway. Like, it's raining, I don't care. It's lightning, I don't care. And some of them end up dead. Wanting to avoid that, we decided to keep on going until we saw the fact that, man, we are not making it up this thing, and it's getting darker. And darker and darker. On top of that, we don't have any access to Wi-Fi to know any of the weather systems coming in. We are flying blind. And these peaks are so high, we can't see what's on the other side of them coming our direction. All of a sudden, not only are we seeing the skies getting darker, but we're seeing these really, really ominous clouds starting to come over the cliffs that we're trying to summit. And that was the point when I realized we're not going to be able to summit. So I took a picture of the peak, and I said, okay, guys, we're 500 feet away. We have to cancel this. And we turn around. And immediately, it was crazy. Like within minutes of turning around, it got dark quick. And not only did it get dark, it started to thunderstorm on us. And so now we're like trying to get our headlamps on and trying to navigate down this mountain in the dark, which was bananas. But the thing was, is that everything that we were going in there to try to do, we realized we couldn't do because dangerous conditions require extreme measures. In this situation, there's only one word for what we had to do, and that was flee. We had to get out of there. We had to avoid this at all costs. We had to evacuate the situation. If we were going to be operating within wisdom, we were thinking about ourselves, we were thinking about our families, we were thinking about again, how dumb it would be for Carlos to get up here and say, yeah, Errol's dead because he's dumb. All those things, we wanted to flee. We had to get out of the situation. And the truth is that what we're talking about with guardrails are intended to direct and protect. You don't set up a guardrail in the ditch at the bottom of the cliff. You set the guardrail in a place of safety so that if you bump into it with some of our dumb decisions, we don't end up in the ditch. We end up with a protective measure. So basically, it's like whatever the danger is, we set our parameters of protection this side of the danger so that, again, should we bump into that, we're going to be okay. And today we're going to be talking specifically about the whole aspect of fidelity, which is comes from the word fidelis, which means, again, faithful and loyal. And fidelity within regard to relationships. Relational fidelity is something where we recognize that God has got this perspective of, he's a big fan of seeing marriages stay and stick and be faithful with one another. That we pour into marriage the intentionality before we're married and after we're married to have this. And this is the crazy thing. There's no one in our culture fighting for this for you. If you're married, everything in our culture is fighting against this. Everything in our culture is conditioning us to say, you know what, I really was in love when I got married, but I no longer am, so therefore, maybe there's a better option for me. You know what, I'm just a human being, and so the heart wants what the heart wants, and so I'm going to orchestrate my life decisions with regard to my sexuality off of what I feel, and that's bottom line. The idea of a faithful and loyal perspective is something that culture, if anything, is fighting against. Our entertainment just celebrates the idea of affairs. And then we're shocked and kind of disgusted and ticked off when our friends have one. So we're complicit. You know, this is something we do. And so again, what Paul is conveying here and communicating is something that has everything to do with fidelity. And honestly, if our world, forget our world, if Christians in our world, which is a lot of people in our world, if we actually had guardrails that protected this, we protected this in our marriages, there would be some differences, game-changing cultural shifts that would take place. One of them is, and this is just reality, if Christians had guardrails set up around their relationships, there would be lower poverty in the world. There would be fewer kids raised without a mom or a dad. There'd be fewer kids in foster care. There'd be fewer men in prison. There would be fewer unwanted physical lines crossed. And there would be fewer people devolving into predators. No matter how prudish it seems, every one of us knows someone that their life would have been better had they had relational guardrails. And that might be you, a lot of us here. Our church, we are trophies of God's grace. A lot of us have come through really, really poor choices in our life that seemed right at the time that now upon further reflection, we realize we're disengaged from God's dream for us. Guardrails are something that we recognize is something that God is incredibly interested in. Fidelity is so important to God and so abused by us, we need guardrails. And so Paul gets into it. He starts out with this, flee from sexual immorality. And the thing that's interesting about that flee word, again, escape, run away, get away from it. It's assuming that you have a choice. It's assuming that you're in a situation where you want to be there. Like the heart wants what the heart wants. Running towards or staying in our sexual immorality is not something that's difficult. All of us do it easy, like with our eyes closed. It's so easy. Paul is saying this normative and natural impulse of your life, as a follower of Jesus, we have a different response. We have a choice, and that's to book it. Book it away from that. Get away from that to run the opposite direction of sexual immorality. You have a choice, and Paul would say you have the ability to do that. But then he says why. He says all other sins in a person commits. And then he goes on from there. When he says all right here, he's saying this. A lot of times as Christians, we're like, dude, one of the things I love about Jesus is that all sin is the same. Doesn't matter what we've done. All sin is forgiven. It's equally forgiven. True? Is that true? We love that, and that's true. But sometimes we get goofy with that, and we think that, well, like all sin is like the same thing. And Paul's like, well, actually, no, all other sins a person commits are different. They're all equally forgiven by Jesus on the cross. So on the cross, whether you are a murderer or you just lied to your grandma that she looked good in a dress when she didn't, you know she didn't. whatever sin you have on the spectrum of sin, it's equally forgiven by Jesus. However, if I'm someone that like tells my grandma, you know, a lie about how she looks, even though I know it's not true, or I'm like an axe murderer, both are forgiven by Jesus. Both are forgiven by Jesus. But you would, and I would agree that they probably have different relational ramifications, correct? Like, grandma, you look beautiful. Grandma, okay, different, right? Paul is saying, even though that, oh yeah, for sure, everything is forgiven equally on the cross, the truth is that there's something about sexual immorality that is uniquely damaging. You can recover from a financial loss. You can recover from some type of a loss of a job or a loss of property or a house fire. And I can tell you that personally, that happens. But there's something about sexual sin that is this life or baggage thing that you have to wrestle with and battle for your life. It's uniquely damaging. And so that's why Paul is like talking to this group of Christians operating in a hyper-sexualized city. Hey, we got a different option for us, and we can actually go forward. And he continues, all other sins a person commits are outside the body, but whoever sins sexually sins against their own body. Okay, so this is what this means. And the sexual immorality in this passage comes from the Greek word porneia. It's where we get the word pornography from. And porneia basically is this. The Corinthians are like, dude, whatever you want to do you, boo-boo. It's cool. We don't care. But Paul's like, yeah, get that. But as far as a Christ follower, we have a different perspective. We actually believe that there's a God who created us and he crafted us, not just as like, you know, choose your own adventure, it's cool, whatever, but actually with a perspective. He designed us with a design. And so the whole concept of sexual immorality is this idea that it breaks the design. And here's the design. The design is a couple says, I pledge my life to you. Like, no matter what, you can get sick, you can get irritable, you can get ugly, you can get whatever, I'm with you till death do us part. It's you and me, faithfully together. That's the covenant. And once making that public announcement, that decision, that's what marriage is, when a person gets married, then after they've dedicated their life to someone, they then can give their body to that person. That we don't actually give our body to someone before we've committed our life to that person, because what that ends up saying is this, I want from your body now what I'm not willing to give you with my life. I love the idea of marriage. Yeah, one day I want to get married, but I got needs now. I'm not ready to tell you it's for life. So I want from your body now what I'm not willing to give you with my life. And what scripture says is that that's natural. That's normative for us to say that. But this anti-normal thing seemingly is what God's craft is for, is to say, I give you my life. And then I give you my body. That's anything outside of that, anything that flirts outside of that, is what is called sexual immorality according to the Christian perspective that Paul is putting forward. And he continues that the person who does this, they actually sin against their own body. So this is self-sabotage. Even though it feels like this is my ideas and this is what I truly want, it truly is self-sabotage. And we all know this. Sometimes we do things that counteract our best interests, right? Like things that we know we shouldn't eat, what do? We jones for those things, man, more than anything, right? It's like, I don't know if you've ever, that's why you don't shop hungry. You go through Jewel and you're starving, you're gonna make terrible decisions that feel so right at the time. God wants me to have this Hostess pie. He wants it, and I want him to want it for me, right? Whoever sins sexually sins against their own body. And then he says this, he says, do you not know? Now this next part is actually, he front loads it with circumstances of what the ramifications of this. But this next part actually isn't that. The next part is actually talking about the fact that we make these decisions not because of consequence avoidance, but for a Christian, it's a different reason. So if you're not a Christian, you could tune out for this next section, okay? This next part really is something that Christians need to hear. And if you're not a Christian, it's gonna be gobbledygook, so just forget it. But for a Christian, lean in on this, because Paul explains why this is so important for us. He says, do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you've received from God? Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is whom you have received from God. Now, here's the crazy thing. This is Corinth. If you go over ancient Corinth, you're going to see tons of temples, right? Like lots of temples. Greeks love temples. Romans love temples. That's where you go and you meet with your god or your goddess. That's where you worship them. I mean, that's where God is. He's right there on the wall. Or he's right there in this like figurine. And so you go to a temple to worship God. And Paul's like, yeah, that's a joke. You don't go to a temple to worship God. God's not confined in a temple. Temples are just a thing. A thing is not sacred. But you are. Paul's argument throughout his texts that we see in the New Testament is this. God is not found in a building. He's not found in a brick and mortar building. He's not found at 412 North Wabena uniquely. God is actually found in another kind of temple, and that temple is your body. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You want to know the value of something? You actually know the value of a container by what it contains. You know a value of a container by what it's contained. One of the things on that trip that we had in Colorado, we were constantly bombarded by these sets of rain thunderstorms that were chasing us. And they were chasing us all throughout Colorado. We came down from the mountain, we caught a train out for Durango, and then we said, we got to find another adventure. And one of the adventures we wanted to get to was the Great Sand Dunes National Park. Our goal was, this is in like southwestern Colorado. And some of these mountains of sand are 750 feet. We're like, okay, we couldn't do a 14,000 foot one, but let's go ahead and get to some of these things and let's actually camp on some of these sand dunes, which is great unless there's thunderstorms. And they're not fans of you doing that. So we booked it, like we're going and we're driving to this huge valley and we see this wall just chasing us. Messed up. I'm like, what's wrong with this world? So we get there and we get to the visitor center. The visitor center is closing their doors and they're like, okay, if you need to go to the bathroom, go to the bathroom, but you need to get out quick because we're closing early because the lightning and thunderstorms are coming this way. I'm like, you guys are park rangers. I always thought of you people as studs. You're wimping out here. Come on. Because I want to see my visitor center. But anyway, so they're shutting down. We're like, okay, if the thunderstorms are coming and we see them coming, we got to go ahead and get to these sand dunes as fast as we can before they kick us out of the park. And that's exactly what we did. And so we go there and we get to these mountains. And so just to remind you of the people that are on this trip, this is my son, Micah. This is a guy named Chris. This is a guy from NBC named Andy. And this is my brother, Josh. Larry's in the car because he, again, was chickening out himself. He was just like, oh, windshield wipers. So weird. And so the rest of us are like, go! And so like we're running as fast as we can to get as high as we can before the storm gets to us, and we have to run back down and get to the car. And so we're going up this, and we're just like, we're sucking air. I mean, it's just like, because even though it's not as high elevation, it's still not Illinois. And so we're going as fast as we can to get up as high as we can. Micah and I get to like one of these hills and we're just like, okay, this is as high as we feel comfortable with because we see lightning. Lightning again, no bueno if you're exposed, which we totally were. And so, but Josh is like, no, I think we should go higher. And these guys are like, sounds good. And so they go up there, we stay right here. And they're like, we're just going to go up to the top. We'll take a picture and we'll run down. We're like, fine. So Chris, Andy, and Josh go up to the top, and sure enough, they get up there, and Micah and I are like, come on, guys, come on. Lightning is coming. We are dead meat. Let's go. The rains are coming. They're not here yet, but we see the wall coming into the Great Sand Dunes National Park. We see the haze on the horizon getting closer and closer. And so sure enough, they're up at the top, and they run down, and we're like, boom, that was great. We all run down. We get to the bottom. We're like, oh, that was just amazing. It was so great. And then Chris goes, oh, dude. And we're like, dude? He's like, oh, dude, my wallet. I don't know where my wallet is. And I'm like, there's 750 feet of sandbox, Chris. And you lost your wallet in it? It took seconds. But I mean, as much as I wanted to just punch him, it took seconds for us just to go, okay. And while everyone is sprinting down the hill, because now the rain has just hit, and everyone's trying to evacuate the area, we are running the opposite direction up into the great giant sandbox of joy to find Chris's wallet. Why would we do such a stupid thing? Because it's his wallet. I don't care about his wallet, but what he has in his wallet is valuable to him. He's got cash, he's got cards, he's got his license, he can't fly without this thing. And so it's not just the container. The container is only as valuable as what it contains. And what Chris's wallet contained was important enough for us to book it back into danger to get, because it was that valuable. One of the things that we need to understand about our lives and our bodies is this: you are valuable, Christian. Your body is valuable because you were created in the image of God. But even more than that, you house the Holy Spirit, God Himself inside of you, which means that your decisions matter with regard to what you do with your body. Paul's whole thing is, it's totally Corinthian to say, look, it's my body, I can do whatever I want with my body. And that's true. But if you're a follower of Jesus, you all of a sudden have a different perspective, that it's not my body and whatever I want to do, it's my body that I actually surrender to God to do things I don't feel inclined towards, but I do anyway because He's God and I'm not. I'm not going to allow my strongest desires define my truest self. I'm not going to let my strongest desires define my truest self. Paul says, you are not your own. You're not your own. Now that seems, again, pretty conservative and prudish, to be honest. And I get that. But the amazing thing that we have as Christians is realizing how valuable it is that we can say that. Like, for example, there was this guitar, like a Martin 18E. A Martin 18E is a really nice guitar, and Martins are really nice guitars, and guitars can be expensive. This particular guitar, if you buy it new, it's like $2,000 to $3,000 for this acoustic guitar. It's like crazy expensive. But recently, in the past several years, one of these Martin 18Es was sold for not $3,000, not $10,000, not $100,000, not $1 million, but $6 million. And it was scratched and used. Why in the world would anyone buy a used, scratched, old Martin E that actually was from 1959? It wasn't even new. Why would anyone spend $6 million on that? Because of who owned it. And this particular guitar that sold for $6 million was the actual guitar that was owned by Kurt Cobain and used in the 1993 MTV Unplugged set that's now iconic, an amazing set of music. And one of the things that when we see that, we recognize that and this we can understand that an instrument's value is determined by who owned it. Not only just the quality of the instrument's significant value comes from who owns it. And the thing that a Christian says, and again, if you're not a Christian, you don't have to worry about this. But if you're a Christian, you recognize that this is an instrument that doesn't belong to me. That my choices with this instrument belong to who owns this instrument. And my wife doesn't own this instrument. Your boyfriend, your girlfriend, your spouse, your boss, your parents don't own that instrument. The person, if you're a follower of Jesus, that owns this instrument is not even myself, but it's God. Now that actually is really exciting if we recognize the fact that as difficult as it is to follow God with this instrument, I get a chance to make decisions based on that. And that is something where I get to understand that I am not my own. Therefore, I get to honor God with my body. Because I'm not my own, I honor God with my body. I get to make decisions. And so I wanted to just encourage a couple of things as far as like suggestions for you to think about. You're going to come up with different conclusions for your relationships or your life. But as a Christian, if you're a follower of Jesus, one thing I want you to be in agreement on is like, what does Scripture say the essence of our sexual expression is? And then be able to say, I need to make convictions and decisions based on my life because of this. Let's start with married people. If you're currently married, then you can set up guardrails to actually fight for the fidelity of your marriage. In a world that's not going to fight for the faithfulness and longevity of your marriage, Scripture and the church and God Himself are. They are fighting for the fidelity and faithfulness in your marriage. So this is what you do. You set up guardrails that are in the place of safety. Not danger, but safety. Let me give you just a couple of examples from Julie and my life. I remember growing up hearing about this thing called the Billy Graham rule, which sounded super prudish and super extreme. But basically it was this. This guy named Billy Graham was around enough pastors who couldn't control themselves and put themselves in bad situations and ended up ending ministry early because of affairs. And he said, I don't want that to be for me. And so he said, I need to protect myself from the worst version of myself. I need to protect any female I'm with from the worst version of herself. And I also need to protect the outward perception from anyone who might see something and find it questionable. So what he did was this. He said, I will never be alone in a room all by myself with a female. I will never ride in a car all by myself with someone who's not my wife. I will never be in an elevator even alone with someone, a female alone, that's not my wife. And that's called the Billy Graham rule, which everyone's like, that is the most ridiculous thing in the world. And that's exactly what I started practicing, and as a staff we practice, and here's why. I don't trust humans. I don't trust men. I don't trust females. And I don't trust people's perception. And so I want to build up guardrails in an area of safety that protects men, women, and outward perception. And so I don't drive in a car by myself with someone that's a female that's not Julie. I don't counsel a female alone in my office, and none of our staff will, unless there is a window to that office where people can see both people, or there's a door that's open so you can see both people. That's to protect myself, that's protect the female that I'm meeting with, and that's protect outward perception. And same thing for cars and everything else. I can't control elevators because people get on. I'm like, oh, okay. You know, you've been on elevators where people get in there, you're like, oh boy, this person really needs to take a shower. I couldn't control that. That's the same thing. You can't control elevators all the time. So I take that off the grid. But everything else, I try to make sure that that's something that I'm operating with wisdom. Now, one really smart pushback to the Billy Graham rule is this. If you have a female business person who's trying to climb the ladder within her corporation and the boss is only going out to lunch with dudes because he's operating by the Billy Graham rule, or he's only meeting alone with dudes because of the Billy Graham rule or whatever, that could really handicap her ability, her capacity to grow in that organization. If you are a male, like that's in management, and that's a boundary you're setting up, then it's incumbent upon you to set up parameters to have upward mobility for the females in your organization that don't require them to meet alone with you or travel alone with you or have lunch alone with you. And you could do that because you're smart. You're in management. And everyone knows people in management are brilliant. And so you could pull this off. But it's incumbent upon you as a Christian who cares about parameters and cares about women is to give them the upward mobility capacity in your organization. Okay, now that's just within the realm of that. I would say that one of the things with as a married couple, but this is for anybody, the whole concept of pornography is just off the table. That's not something that I'm going to engage. And here's why: pornography is programming. Pornography is programming. It's programming your brain. It's programming your brain for what to look for, what to engage, what to enjoy. And the weird thing is that studies have found that those who engage in pornography the most have the least satisfaction in actual intimacy, sexual intercourse. And so, and it's almost as if God designed us not for that. Crazy. But here's the thing. What I do is I have to operate in such a way that I am setting myself up for success by having a parameter. That's just not going to show up in our relationship. It's not going to show up in my life. And when it does, it is confessed and repented because that's not something that's okay. There's zero parameters for that to be okay with us. If there's a person that your spouse is uneasy with, there have been points in our marriage where Julie said, you know what? I just don't feel cool with you hanging out with this lady that's in our church or in this lady that's in our community. And you want to know how I responded to that? Thank you. Thank you so. No, I didn't say that. I was like, what? They're fine. I'm fine. What's fine? What's the problem with that? Because I'm defensive. That's my nature. But one of the things that we need to do as husbands and wives is listen to the people that are in our world, in our realm. And if they're saying, I don't feel cool with you spending time with this person, listen. That should be one of those red flags that goes up and gives us the opportunity to listen to that. If you're single if you're single, everything I just said about married people, apply it to married people. Like if there's a married man and you're like, if you're like a 19-year-old lady and there's a married 45-year-old who wants to go and spend time alone with you, there's a good answer for that. Step off. Get away. No. And you actually can set up parameters to protect yourself from married people. Do that. I would say that as a single person, you know, the other rules as far as being alone with the opposite gender, that's different. But you need to definitely protect yourself from married people. But if you're someone who's a single person that's dating and you're a Christ follower that's recognizing, I want to honor God with my body, one body. I want to honor God with my body and our bodies. then you have to have a conversation. If you're a follower of Jesus, you have to have a conversation about this. Where you say, listen, this may not be what we've already been practicing as a couple. Or this may sound super prudish, and this is the third date and it's awkward. But I just want to convey to you, kind of as a follower of Jesus, I recognize that my body's not my own. And so I'm like protecting this thing that God seems to think is important. I don't want to do it, but I love him and I trust him. And so I'm going to orchestrate my life based on decisions that are actually encouraging and cheerleading my greatest success, not my greatest failure. Talk about it. Share with them your parameters. Julie and I, we had to set up parameters. We set up parameters right when we first started dating. And our goal was we want to be two married people that enter into our honeymoon as two ignorant virgins who actually are starting that component of our relationship then. And I would love to tell you that that was the easiest thing in the world to do, and it wasn't. It was like bananas difficult. Bananas difficult. Crazy town difficult. I never regret it for one second. Like, not one second. Now, here's the cool thing. Here's the cool thing. One of the wonderful things that we have as Christians is this. Many of us in this room have already gone too far. Some of us are like, this would be great to have heard 10 years ago. Thanks for bringing it up now, Pastor. But the truth is that in Christ, there's no condemnation. That means that whatever you have done, guilt and shame are gone. When you surrender that to Jesus, no matter what you have done, guilt and shame are gone. And you have the ability to almost be like a newborn baby, where it's like you're born again with a fresh slate. All right. That all happened, but from this point on, I'm making this decision. And that's today for many of you. I want to encourage you. NBC, we are a church full of people who have committed adultery, who have been addicted to pornography, who are in different situations of sexual sin. We're a church of people that are experiencing great success right now and falling flat on their face. We're a church of people that are full of people that are like, man, we love each other and we've been dating forever, and so we decided to live together, and we're listening to this and we're realizing that that's not in alignment with what God has called us to do. And let me just tell you, if you're someone who's dating and living together, we as a church are all about cheerleading your greatest success. And one of the things I've loved so much as a pastor is talking with couples that are living together going, okay, we want to follow Jesus, and yet we're living together. What do we do? And loved walking with them on next steps on how to actually start to bring their life into alignment with God's call. And it's so cool because there's no shame, there's no guilt. It's all about how do I walk in alignment with Jesus. Now, here's the cool thing. That might sound too extreme for a lot of us, everything I just said. But relationships are dangerous. And conditions of danger calls for extreme measures. And I just want to encourage you also with this, is that honestly, with regard to sexual immorality, we have two choices with regard to sexual immorality. We flirt with it, we see it as close as we can get to it, and then wonder why we get burned by it, or we flee. We avoid it at all costs. We orchestrate our decisions off of it. Now, if you make that decision today, as much as I would love to say people are going to think you're just amazing, the truth is that there will be no standing ovations for setting up guardrails now in your relationship. None. You're dating someone, you've been dating them for like 9 months, and you guys have a great sex life right now, but you realize it's not in alignment with God, and you bring up this stuff, they're not going to say, thank you. I was waiting for you to say that. I've been wondering when you would for 9 months. They're not going to say that. They're going to be like, what are you doing? You're ruining our relationship. There will be no standing ovations for those setting up guardrails now. But there will be later and for longer. Your kids will benefit from it. Your relationship will benefit from it. Your future marriage will benefit from it. The person you're currently dating's marriage will benefit from it. There will be no standing ovations now. It'll be really difficult, but there will be later and for longer. And you'll be able to look at your spouse, whether you've been married to them for 15, 20, 35 years, or you plan to get married to them one day, maybe, and you'll be able to look at whoever your spouse is and be able to say, you are mine, and I'm faithfully yours. Let's stand for prayer. Lord Jesus, we recognize that as far as difficulty, this is a this could be a Mount Everest difficulty as far as making some of these decisions. It goes against everything in our grain and everything that our culture is celebrating, and we get it. We understand why they celebrate it, but God, you consistently are bringing us to a different perspective where we live in submission to you. Lord, for those who are followers of Jesus in this room, I pray that you give them boldness and courage and strength to be able to make decisions and guardrails in their relationship that reflect your will and your perspective. Lord, I pray you bless their relationships as a result of that. Lord, I pray that you bless the marriages in this room that are making decisions to alter decisions that they previously were making that are not in alignment with you and instead choosing to honor you and your passion for fidelity and faithfulness and loyalty, God. Lord, I pray that this is something that our communities around us see. It's going to stand in stark contrast, God, to everything that's being encouraged. But I pray that they get a chance to see a glimpse of people fleeing what everyone else runs towards, fleeing what everyone else flirts with, and instead experiencing the life that you've called them to. And Lord, I pray that that'll be one that we'll be able to give you the glory and the thanks for helping us out with. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's go live it out. See you next week, folks.